thanks for staying with a special edition of Spotlight. I'm Eric Wotilla here in the MyNews 26 studios, and I'm joined today by Congressman John Moolenaar, who has been kind enough to spend a little bit of time in our studio this week. And Congressman Moolenaar, I know there's been a lot going on in Washington, and it's been a couple years since we talked here in the studio. I understand the committees you've been involved with have changed a little bit. Do you want to tell us a little about that?
Sure. Well, thanks for having me, Eric, and I'm pleased to be with you today. And I'm serving on the Appropriations Committee, which is the spending committee that prioritizes spending for our government. And there are 12 subcommittees, which mean 12 different bills. I'm on three different subcommittees. One oversees the Labor, Health and Human Services, and Education departments. Another is the Financial Services area, which oversees the IRS. And then the third is Legislative Branch, which oversees things like Library of Congress and some of the other institutions of Congress. And we're really pleased to be able to pass all 12 appropriations bills through the House last week. And that's some exciting news because that's the first time it's been done in a long, long time. And so we're excited about that progress.
So these things that you've passed through in the last week, can you elaborate a little bit on what you've been working on there?
Sure. Well, we want to make sure our defenses are stronger, so it includes $640 billion for our defense, plus some overseas contingency funding for a situation like Afghanistan and Iraq, and making sure that in Syria we have the resources we need to fight terrorism. But then also we fund priorities like the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative. That was a concern early on that that funding might go away. We ensure that we keep that $300 million in there to fight against Asian carp, other invasive species, and make sure we protect our Great Lakes from threats.
Very nice. And of course, the Great Lakes are an important topic here in northern Michigan, Michigan as
sure.
a whole. Can you, you mentioned that that's continuing funding for the Great Lakes and for keeping them safe. Can you elaborate on what exactly that funding is being used
sure.
for, how that's being utilized?
Sure. Well, you know, you think about the Great Lakes, this also includes the ecosystem that goes into the Great Lakes, the rivers and streams, the aquifers, the wetland protection that makes sure we have filters so that our lakes are clean. This $300 million goes and funds important research that's done on invasive species. You know, so many of the different challenges we face in our lakes are due to invasive species, and we want to make sure we understand the threat posed and how to combat that. Also, when you consider the Asian carp, that's a huge concern. There was Asian carp found within 9 miles of Lake Michigan. In our legislation, we also required the Army Corps of Engineers to release a study on the Brandon Road lock, which is near Chicago, looking at options on how to prevent the Asian carp from getting further into the Great Lakes.
Now, an interesting note on that note of kind of this research, how involved is the EPA in this side of things, or is this different agencies that are being involved?
No, the EPA is involved in this. Some of the funding also includes funding for sediment, you know, toxic sediment withdrawal. You know, the interesting thing is that citizens can actually participate in this through the Army Corps of Engineers. There is a hearing time frame where you can submit comments, ideas on different, you know, there's all the different proposals of, you know, electric barriers, sound barriers, an actual physical separation, you know, a variety of ideas with different time frames. And that, as policymakers, is something we want to make sure we address the problem in the short run, but also have a better long-term solution.
Now, as coming up with those solutions goes, obviously, you know, on a federal level, you're dealing with government oversight.
Sure.
Just under 2 years ago in here, you were talking about kind of trying to reduce government overreach, and you specifically mentioned the EPA on that note. So how does that tie in with things like monitoring the Asian carp situation?
Sure. Well, we've really addressed the EPA. You know, the EPA was going in a political direction on all sorts of areas that really weren't part of their mission. And they had a huge overreach, mission creep, if you will. They were getting involved in all sorts of activities that, in my view, were more political. For instance, when we had the Waters of the U.S. rule, they were actually conducting a Facebook campaign to support their own rule, using government resources to do that. And of course, in this administration, we've actually repealed that rule because it would have restricted, you know, our property rights. It would have had the EPA overseeing mud puddles on farmers' property. So we've really pulled them back from that agenda. We have a new administrator, but at the same time, they have a core responsibility of cleaning up, you know, environmental hazards. They also, when it comes to our Great Lakes, you know, we have multiple states involved. We have two countries involved. It's an international border. And to me, there's a vital national interest. 20% of the world's fresh water are in our Great Lakes.
And speaking of water, of course, the Great Lakes are a big part of the water here in northern Michigan, but also something that's been a topic here in Michigan especially is water infrastructure. And I understand there are some rural communities especially throughout the state that face aging infrastructure in terms of, you know, water, other types of infrastructure as well. But what's being done to help the infrastructure in these smaller communities?
Well, I think the situation in Flint really raised the level of awareness of concerns when you have aging underground infrastructure, especially with respect to water. We need to make sure we're doing the kinds of maintenance, making sure the technologies are there. Rural communities face this in a similar way that urban communities, and I think the Flint situation put the focus on an urban community. We also need to be mindful of our rural communities, and so we actually have been working with some of the you know, rural development and trying to find ways to improve our rural infrastructure.
Certainly, and let's see, there was one other question on the note of water here that we're talking about, the Sioux Locks.
Yes.
And that, of course, is a major topic, again, for northern Michigan. I understand there's talk of construction of a new lock in that area. Can you elaborate on that project a little bit?
Well, that's something that is very much in need as we go forward. When you consider the large freighters that go through the Sioux Locks, there's only one lock currently, the Poe Lock, which can handle the kinds of large freighters that carry agricultural products, but also steel and raw materials that go into steel, iron ore. And so when we consider that's a 50-year-old lock, if it were ever to go down, there was a report done by the Homeland Security that said this was kind of the Achilles heel of the economy. When you consider the automotive industry, appliances, you know, there's so many areas that depend on this steel that, you know, comes through there. And so we've been looking at ways to improve that. I had a chance to tour the Sioux Locks. We've been talking, you know, the governor's very interested in a new lock at the Sioux Locks. Now, if you go outside of Michigan, most people don't know about the Sioux Locks. And so one of my goals has been to help educate, you know, the president's budget director, put this on the radar screen with the White House and with other leaders, you know, of different committees in Congress who may not be familiar with the Sioux Locks, but they sure would be if the Sioux Locks were ever, if that lock were ever to go down, it would affect the entire economy of our country. And some estimates said that it would increase unemployment up to about 11% if there was a sustained shutdown. So we do believe there needs to be a new lock. It's been authorized twice by Congress in the past, but never built. But it's about $1 billion cost. And so, you know, that kind of a investment, we need to have a lot of broad support in Congress as well as the president. And we're working in a bipartisan way to start to build that support.
Certainly, and speaking of building support, the budget is a major topic that is going on right now. And when we come back, we're going to talk about the budget and the potential threat of a government shutdown if that budget's not passed. You're watching a special edition of Spotlight with Congressman John Moolenaar. We'll be right back.